So you've probably seen graphics like this before in games or in other applications. What you haven't seen is seen this running intrinsically in the web browser. So the technology clearly has great potential. Let me walk you through some of the interesting aspects of this demo to show you more about it. So first off, notice the visual quality here. We have very high resolution texture maps on the surfaces of the rocks, of the trees, of the bottom, of the seafloor under the water, and of the sky itself. We also have what are called bump maps. So we have detailed textures on the surfaces that describe the local surface texture, the physical shape of the surface, which gives us very realistic lighting as the light bounces off the scene and hits the viewer. We're also doing some very advanced shading techniques on the water. So you can see that we've implemented reflection and refraction. And these are coded right in the source code of the application, so the application can control the visual appearance of the water or other attributes of the scene. The next thing that we focused on was performance. So you'll notice we're running at a smooth 60 hertz here. It gives it this very smooth, liquid feel, like you're really there, you're in the scene. The same level of performance that you would expect to see from a native application running on the operating system. And here we're seeing it in the browser. The other interesting aspect is we're doing all of the graphics on the graphics processor, on the GPU. So the CPU load as we run this application is less than 10%. So the CPU is still there for you to use in your JavaScript code and by the browser to implement your application logic, which is extremely important. And then the last point about the demo that's interesting is it's all JavaScript code. So you have all the nice attributes of JavaScript for web development. You can edit the code right on your machine, test it on your machine, deploy it easily. No complicated build process. It's just JavaScript. So this is very cool technology, but we still have a long way to go until we achieve our dream. What we want to get to is the point where you type a URL in the address bar, go to a website, and play a rich, interesting 3D graphics application. In order for this to happen, we need this capability to be built into the browsers by default. So we need a common set of APIs that are implemented widely by all the browser vendors so that your browser of choice does this intrinsically. It becomes a feature of the browser itself. The key here is standardization. So we at Google are working very closely with Apple, Mozilla, Opera, and others in the context of the standards organizations to make this a reality. So we still have a ways to go, but we've begun the process of standardization for how 3D graphics will work on the web. And we invite you to join that discussion. The other thing is we have to put it in the browser itself. And so we're hard at work at Google integrating 3D graphics capabilities like these into the Chromium code base so that Chrome has the ability to do this without the need of any plugin whatsoever. So we're very excited about the directions this is going. So this is all very cool. It looks neat. It's very fun. It's nice to see the web gain these capabilities. But it's still just a demo. We're still in the very early phase. This is a plug-in today. We're very excited about the future. The other key to the puzzle here is applications. We want to see real-world applications emerge where you and people like you make applications and websites that use these capabilities to their full advantage. What is the next killer 3D graphics applications on your website? Is it a game? Is it data visualization? Is it an engineering application? Is it something new? So we're very excited about the prospects for the future, and we hope you will check it out and join us in pushing it over the finish line.
Obviously, if you'd like to learn more about what Matt just showed you, there's the URL, and you can get all the details, in addition to the sessions that we're having on it. Going back to the Canvas capability, remember, developers are not going to use Canvas if it isn't broadly available. And we're very happy to report that across all modern open source browsers, Chrome, Firefox, Safari, we have this capability. I hear some of the laughter. You must be wondering why I didn't mention Internet Explorer. Let me talk about that briefly. Obviously, Microsoft, with its very large market share, could do much to move the web forward. And so you can imagine how excited we were to hear Microsoft's public statements about their commitment to the HTML5 standards. And that very, very much excites us, and we eagerly await to see evidence of that. That's all I'm going to mention about IE today. Now that I've danced past that elephant, let's move on. let's talk about video. Just like I asked you with Canvas, let me ask you with video. How do you play video in a browser today? You know, as a developer, you really have a tough job. You got to ensure that your users have the correct plugin installed in their browser. In addition to having a plugin installed, you've got to ask yourself, does that plugin support the appropriate codec that's going to that video is encoded in? And there are some variables that are outside of your control as a developer. So video is hard. You might ask yourself, if you were responsible for moving the web forward, what would Occam do? Well, how about a video tag as simple as image? That's exactly what HTML5 video gives you. A simple tag where you point it to the source and the browser handles the rest. Let me show you some examples. Let's go to machine one.
Billy's been trying to customize his web browser.
This will make it go faster.
Okay, that's one way to make the web go faster. It's a video playing in the browser, no big deal, until you look at the source code. And you look at the source code here, and you can see use of the video tag to play that video, and nothing more than JavaScript to play and stop it. Of course, because it's integrated right within the browser, let's go back to that demo. One of the benefits is I can start a rotate. This is just a simple JavaScript, CSS, transform, and look, I'm rotating the video. I can even play it if I wanted to. But it gives you a sense of the advantage of using something that's intrinsic to that web programming model. DOM manipulation, just like any other element with the video tag. Let's go on to the next demonstration. This is an experiment. We are not announcing today that YouTube is going to be built this way. This is a demo that we just wanted to show you to get the creative juices going. Obviously, YouTube is a site that you no doubt know and love. This looks like YouTube. In fact, there's one change that's pretty significant, which is if you actually look at the source here, it's implemented using the video tag. And because it's implemented using the video tag, those videos play and they're intrinsic to that HTML page. You see as he mouses over the thumbnails, they just play. Those are not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 plugins. I'm not marshaling across boundaries. This is JavaScript, the video tag, and that's it. And it kind of gives you an example of where we might be going in the future. All right, let's go back to the slides. Once again, very happy to say across modern browsers, broad support has been implemented for the video tag. Now let's talk about geolocation. At Google, we believe that almost all kinds of apps could be better if they had access to geolocation. Everything from business software to social software. And think about your CRM software if you're a business. When your sales agent lands in Denver, why doesn't the CRM software recognize his location and show him or her the current customers based on proximity? In social software, why isn't the photo automatically geotagged? Why aren't my updates, my tweets, automatically tagged with location? Well, the reality is that accessing location and using it is hard today. You might think, well, what about GPS? GPS takes a long time to get a fix. GPS may often not work indoors. What about IP, IP-based location? Well, it's too fuzzy. It's not granular enough. I mean, heaven forbid your users are AOL users, where the IP has gone through a proxy in Virginia and all the location reports is Virginia. And so it hasn't been possible to get good quality data sources until the last year. Companies like Skyhook, companies like Google, and others have created large databases of Wi-Fi data and cell ID data, and really have mapped the entire world with coverage. These sources, combined with GPS and other sources, have now given us the ability to accurately triangulate or pinpoint an individual's location with their consent. Of course, you might be wondering, well, that's good, that's great, Vic, but how do you get it in the browser? Well, guess what? The last year, we have seen tremendous progress with standardization of the W3c Geolocation API, which is implemented in these browsers. So you, as a developer, can take advantage of these capabilities. To demonstrate these and kind of talk about them, I'd like to invite up Jay Sullivan, Vice President from Mozilla. Jay, welcome.
Thanks, Vic. Good to see you.
Jay. Just one moment before you go into your presentation and demo here, I did want to take a moment and just say thank you to the Mozilla community. To a large extent, we have the luxury this morning of talking about modern browsers.